Welcome to the complete story of Crisis Core, Final Fantasy VII Reunion. The prequel to the much-beloved Final Fantasy VII and the remaster of the original Crisis Core, which had been unavailable on modern hardware for way too long, making this a very welcome reunion indeed. As remasters go, the game is an ambitious work which manages to breathe new life into an otherwise older title, making it more fun to play and a real joy to behold. At the same time, it serves as a gateway into a part of Final Fantasy VII's story that has been overlooked by many, due to the game having been unavailable for so long. Therefore, with the next title in the Final Fantasy VII Remake saga on the horizon, the return of Crisis Core couldn't have come at a better time. But anyway, I'm Pétur from Birds of Play, and in this video, I hope you'll join me as we revisit the complete story of Crisis Core, Final Fantasy VII Reunion, a story of brotherhood, dreams, and honor. It's going to take a while to get to the core of this crisis, but I hope you'll be with us every step of the way. Prologue. Surrounded by construction cranes and the eerie green glow of Mako energy, the offices of the Shinra Electric Power Company oversee the construction of Midgar, a massive industrial metropolis founded on the promises of Mako as an energy source. Suddenly, a train hijacked by Wutai troops, a nation currently at war with Shinra, breaks through a checkpoint heading to Sector 8. In order to stop their advance, a soldier operative, a part of Shinra's elite fighting force, is inserted in order to neutralize the situation. Jumping from a helicopter onto the moving train, the soldier, named Sack Fair, is joined by his mentor, Anne Geel, who tells him that there are no Shinra troops aboard the train, allowing Sack to let loose. Sack takes full advantage of this opportunity, displaying his incredible physical prowess in the process by single-handedly breaking through the enemy ranks, proving himself a formidable foe, even though he is still just a soldier second class. After rerouting the train to Sector 1, Sack jumps off at the platform and continues to neutralize the threat to the city, telling Anne Geel that he will make soldier first class in no time. However, after bringing down a massive behemoth in the middle of the street, Sack is suddenly attacked from behind by none other than Sephiroth, a legendary soldier first class who quickly brings him to his knees and smashes his sword in two. Before things can escalate any further, Anne Geel puts an end to the fight before picking up his phone and aborting the mission, revealing it to have been nothing but an intricate computer simulation designed to train soldier operatives. Anne Geel passes Sack his broken sword and tells him that if he wants to be a hero, he must embrace his dreams and have honor. After Anne Geel and Sack leave the training room, Sack airs his frustrations by performing a series of squats out in the open. He is joined by his friend Kunzel, who tells him that the reason he isn't getting any assignments is that there's been a mass desertion at Soldier, led by one of the firsts, who took a bunch of seconds and thirds with him. Before they can discuss the matter further, Anne Geel comes to pick him up, telling him to head to Soldier Director Lazard's office for a mission briefing. During the briefing, Sack learns that Genesis, a soldier first class, is missing in action, and that he is to go to Wutai to take over his mission. Anne Geel informs Sack that he has recommended him for a promotion to first, asking him not to make him regret his decision. Before setting out, Director Lazard asks Sack whether his dream is to become first, but Sack responds that his dream is to become a hero. Lazard smiles, telling him that unattainable dreams are the best kind. As they approach Fort Tamblin in Wutai, Anne Geel tells Sack about dumb apples, a fruit native to his home village of Banora, the apples being named for the fact that they ripen at random times during the year. Being raised poor, Anne Geel grew up stealing dumb apples from the local farms. But there was one tree that Anne Geel would never steal from, even though those apples were rumored to taste the best. The reason was that he was friends with the son of the wealthy man who owned the tree, Andrea's honor stopping him from taking the apples or asking for handouts. Afterwards, Zack asks Angeal about his weapon, the Buster Sword, because he's never actually seen him use it in battle. Angeal retorting that use brings about wear, tear, and rust, and that he's too cheap to waste it. The two split up, and Zack infiltrates the fortress alone. Inside, he comes across a young girl called Yuffie, who runs off after proclaiming herself to be the savior of Wutai. As Zack reaches the heart of the fortress, he is ambushed by monsters and ultimately saved by Angeal. When he notes that Angeal used the Buster's Sword to save him, his mentor remarks that Zack's life is slightly more important than his sword, but just a little. On the way back, they are joined by Director Lazard, who's there to oversee the mission. But before they can rendezvous with Sephiroth, they are ambushed by mysterious aggressors. After the battle, as Zack attempts to examine the fallen bodies of their new enemy, someone summons an Ifrit to attack him. Zack is able to hold his own against the summon, but ends up letting his guard down too soon. This time, Zack is rescued by Sephiroth, who defeats the beast in his place, allowing them to finally examine the bodies of the people who attacked them, revealing them to be copies of Genesis, the missing soldier first class. With Angeal nowhere to be found, Zack leaves with Sephiroth. Sephiroth believing that Angeal has betrayed them and deserted the ranks of soldier along with Genesis. Back at the Shinra building, Zack refuses to believe that his friend and mentor would betray them. In order to uncover the truth, he is sent to Banora Village, along with Tseng of the Turks, Shinra's intelligence agency, to investigate Genesis' disappearance. In Banora, Tseng explains that Genesis and Angeal were in fact childhood friends who grew up in the village together. Genesis being the son of the wealthy man who Angeal refused to steal from. During their investigation, Zack and Tseng find several graves, including those of Genesis' parents. As Tseng examines the graves, Zack explores the abandoned town, where he meets Jillian Hewley, Angeal's mother, who asks if he is Zack the puppy, Angeal having told her about him. Jillian tells him that Genesis returned to town a month ago with an army of cohorts and proceeded to take the lives of many townspeople. Zack asks whether Angeal is in town as well, but Jillian informs him that Angeal had come and gone, leaving only his sword behind, the sword representing their family's honor. Zack and Tseng proceed to search for Genesis, their investigation bringing them to the apple juice factory Genesis has made into his base of operations. Inside, Zack confronts Genesis, who quotes from Loveless, an epic poem about three men who set out on a quest to find the fabled gift of the goddess. Genesis admits to murdering his parents and the townspeople before attacking Tseng and Zack, only for Angeal to stop his rampage. Tseng informs Zack that Shinra plans to destroy the village to conceal the events from the general public. So Zack races downtown to warn Jillian. However, when he arrives at Angeal's childhood home, he finds her lying on the floor with Angeal standing over her. Zack is shocked and enraged by the idea of Angeal killing his own mother, and questions him about the code of honor he claims to live by. As Zack tries to pry answers from Angeal, Genesis gets in his way and summons Bahamut to fight him, allowing Angeal time to disappear. Zack scolds Genesis for misusing summons in this way, telling him it doesn't befit the dreams and honor of soldier. Genesis retorts that he is not a soldier, but rather a monster, before suddenly sprouting a single black wing and flying away. As per Tseng's warning, the town is bombed by Shinra Army aircraft, Zack and Tseng evacuating via helicopter. As the town and dumb apple trees burn to the ground, Zack looks back one last time. Back at the Shinra building, Zack is promoted to Soldier First Class by Soldier Director Lazard. But as they discuss how to deal with Genesis and Angeal, the building is attacked. Zack rushes to the lobby to fend off the intruders, and as he discovers that they are Genesis copies, Sephiroth surmises that the attack is the work of an ex-Shinra scientist called Hollander, who ran away with a copy tech after having been passed over by Professor Hojo to head the science department at the company. Sephiroth doesn't want to believe that Genesis is a puppet in Hollander's petty schemes, so he and Zack venture forth to ascertain the truth of things. As Zack makes his way through Sector 8, he encounters the Turks, Rude, Reno, and Tseng, before being introduced to Cisne. As the Turks and Soldier do their best to protect Midgar, Zack ends up saving Cisne from a Genesis copy. Afterwards, as Cisne inspects the one-winged Genesis copy lying lifeless in the middle of the street, she confides in Zack that when she was a kid, she always wanted to have wings, like an angel. Zack retorts that if people had wings, they'd be monsters. But Cisne says that wings symbolize freedom for those who have none, Zack seemingly finding comfort in her words. As Cisne departs, Zack gets a call from Sephiroth, asking him to come to Mako Reactor 5, where Angeal has been spotted. Initially, Zack is reluctant to hunt down his old mentor, but Sephiroth plans to let Angeal escape before the Shinra army finds him. Inside the reactor, the two find monsters with Angeal's face on their bodies, similar to the Genesis copies that make up Genesis's army. As they pass a training room, Sephiroth reminisces about a training exercise between himself, Angeal, and Genesis inside the Shinra virtual reality system. During the exercise, Genesis had recited a part of Loveless, envisioning himself and his two soldier first-class comrades as the three men foretold in the epic. Genesis wanted to play the part of the hero in the story, and envied Sephiroth's fame as the soldier hero, challenging him by himself to prove his superiority. However, as things went too far, Angeal was forced to intervene in order to stop Genesis and Sephiroth from destroying the compound. As a result, Genesis sustained a wound to his shoulder and later received a blood transfusion from Angeal. Sephiroth being told his blood was incompatible by Hollander, who oversaw the transfusion. However, the wound refused to heal and became the onset of Genesis's degradation. Deeper within the reactor, Zack and Sephiroth find documents on Genova Project G, the branch of the Genova Project that created both Genesis and Angeal, but was deemed a failure. Sephiroth conjectures that the G stands for Project Genesis, and learns that Genesis is suffering from degradation, slowly dying because of his tainted birth. Hollander arrives on the scene and is promptly joined by Genesis, the latter having joined him in the hope of stopping the degradation. As Genesis confronts Sephiroth, Zack chases after Hollander. However, as Zack catches up to him, Angeal arrives to stop him. Angeal sprouts a single white wing, explaining to Zack that he too has become a monster. Zack tries to convince his former mentor that his wings do not belong to a monster, but rather an angel. But Angeal says that angels dream of being human. As Angeal attacks Zack, Zack refuses to fight his old friend, so he sends Zack plummeting down into the Midgar slums below. Falling directly into a church in Sector 5, Zack lands in a flower bed, tended to by a slum dweller named Aerith Gainsborough. She calls out to him until he comes to, and as Zack regains consciousness, he mistakes her for an angel. Zack is surprised by all the flowers, and he tells Aerith that she should sell them, making Midgar full of flowers and her wallet full of money. Aerith offers to guide him around the slums, and makes Zack blush by admitting that she wants to spend more time with him. On the way, Zack has his wallet stolen by a kid named Bruno, who needs money after his wallet got eaten by a monster. Instead of punishing Bruno, however, Zack salvages his wallet from the monster and wins the approval of the people of the slums. He then promises to help Aerith make a wagon for her flower business, and buys her a pink hair ribbon as a memento of their day together. Afterwards, Zack and Aerith go on a date in the park, and Aerith reveals that she is afraid of Soldier and the sky, as she has lived her life under the plate and rarely sees it. Zack reveals that he is a member of Soldier, and that his eyes have a strange glow due to having undergone a procedure of Marco enhancement. Aerith comments that if the sky resembled Zack's eyes, it's not so scary after all. Suddenly, Zack is forced to return to the top of the plate due to another Genesis attack, this time targeting Professor Hojo. While Sephiroth is sent to secure the president, Zack is sent to Hojo's aid. On the way, he is intercepted by Angeal, who has finally decided to take a side, telling Zack that their enemy is all that creates suffering. Zack agrees to help, and Angeal carries him to the Shinra building by flying him there. As Zack reaches the science department, Genesis confronts Hojo, who rebuffs Genesis and claims that Hollander is a second-rate scientist who won't be able to cure his degradation. Genesis quotes passages from Lovelace, believing the gift of the goddess, spoken of in the epic, can cure him. Hojo disregards Lovelace and the gift of the goddess as unscientific, and as Genesis makes his escape, Angeal and Zack give pursuit. Genesis once again performs a summon to aid his escape, this time summoning Bahamut Fury to fight Zack, while Angeal continues to chase after his childhood friend and former comrade. Zack ultimately bests the beast, but by then, Genesis and Angeal are long gone, leaving him behind. Without a clue as to where Genesis has run off to, Zack visits the slums once again to build a flower wagon for Aerith. However, Angeal finds him and tells him that Genesis and Hollander are hiding in the abandoned town of Modeoheim, in the frigid wastes of the northern continent. Zack continues on his way to see Aerith, but is once again intercepted, this time by Tseng, who has a helicopter waiting for him to take them straight to Modeoheim. On the way there, the helicopter is shot down by Genesis' forces, and the group is forced to trek through the snowy terrain, during which time Zack makes the acquaintance of a Shinra infantryman called Cloud Strife. Since both Zack and Cloud are country boys, the two become quick friends. Cloud asks Zack what it's like to be Soldier, but Zack replies that he'll know once he joins up. At Modeoheim, Zack and the team find an abandoned warehouse Genesis has been using as a base. Zack storms the facility and rescues Hollander from a vengeful Genesis, angry at Hollander's failure to stop his degradation. He has decided to look for Genova cells to act as a cure, but Hollander protests that no one knows where Genova, the extraterrestrial lifeform Shinra initially mistook for a member of the Ancients, is stored. A weakened Genesis tries to fight Zack, but is defeated and sent plummeting down into the abyss below the warehouse, thereafter presumed to be dead. At a ruined bathhouse, Zack finds Angeal and Hollander. The latter explains how Angeal is the true success of Project T, having Genova's power as a two-way genetic conduit, able to pass on his genes and take in those of other organisms. It turns out the G in Project G doesn't stand for Project Genesis, but rather Project Jillian, named after Angeal's mother, whom Hollander injected with Genova's cells in an attempt to create a human with the powers of the Ancients. While Genesis was injected with Jillian's cells, resulting in an incomplete version of Genova's power, leading to his current degradation, Angeal received his mother's cells directly while in the womb, and thus grew up into a perfect specimen. It is revealed Angeal did not kill his mother, but rather she had to take her own life in shame. Angeal, similarly no longer wishing to live and suffer as a monster, absorbs several different copies and turns into a hideous creature. Angeal penances to fight Zack. Zack defeats the creature, and in his final moments, Angeal thanks him before passing on the Buster's sword and the legacy of Soldier to Zack. Dr. Hollander is captured, and with all three major threats to Shinra gone, the Genesis War has seemingly concluded. Back in Midgar, a mournful Zack is comforted by Aerith at the church, before rising to the occasion and taking up Angeal's mantle as the heart and soul of Soldier. giving a rousing speech to the recruits, telling them to embrace their dreams and protect their honor as soldier. Having earned some rest, Shinra sends Zack to Costa del Sol to recuperate. But as the ever-eager soldier first class fails to relax on the beach, he keeps squatting his worries away. Trying to take his mind off things, Zack tries to call Aerith. But Cisne, who had been sent to keep an eye on him, seems to know who he's planning on calling. When Zack asks whether he's being watched, Cisne responds that it is in fact Aerith who's being watched, the reason being that she is the last of the ancients. Zack is surprised by this revelation, although he finds it quite fitting, since he already knows that Aerith is one of a kind. Suddenly, Tseng arrives on the scene and warns them just before Genesis copies emerge from the sea to attack them. Zack defeats the copies using a parasol as a weapon, and Tseng speculates that Genesis is controlling them from the life stream, the stream of spiritual energy which courses through the planet. Tseng informs Zack that the city of Junon is under attack and that they must leave immediately. Zack's job is to secure Hollander, who is being interrogated there, and the top secret information he holds, making him priority one. However, Hollander is able to escape captivity thanks to a well-coordinated attack based on information leaked by Director Lazard, who is revealed to be a traitor. Zack chases Hollander through Junon, but he is ultimately flown to safety by Genesis copies, while Genesis himself, alive but still suffering from degradation, watches on. Back in Midgar, Zack finds Aerith in the church being ambushed by Shinra robots, but a canine, winged, angel copy helps her, and afterwards makes its abode in the church rafters. Initially wary of the beast, Zack recognizes it as Angeal's legacy. Having quelled the immediate threat, Zack gets to work at gathering materials for the flower wagon he had promised to build for Aerith. After gathering the materials, Zack is able to build the wagon, but Aerith isn't completely satisfied with how it turned out, hoping that Zack can spend more time with her to make her wishes come true. Before they can take the wagon for a spin, however, Zack gets called back to headquarters by Sephiroth, who has taken over soldier operations in the absence of Director Lazard. He tells them that he and Zack are being dispatched to a macro reactor in Nibelheim, the hometown of Cloud, to investigate disturbances that may be related to Genesis. Sephiroth warns Zack that depending on what happens, he may decide to abandon Shinra, but that until then he will remain loyal to Soldier. As Zack waits for everyone to mobilize for the mission, he uses the opportunity to go visit Aerith one more time. Together they take the flower wagon for a test drive, although they don't manage to sell as many flowers as they had hoped. Aerith is nevertheless content, since she got to spend more time with Zack. Sephiroth, Zack, Cloud, and another Shinra guard arrive in Nibelheim and are led to the Nibel reactor on Mount Nibel by a guide, a village girl named Tifa Lockhart. However, Cloud, a native of Nibelheim, conceals his identity from Tifa and the town due to embarrassment of having failed to enter Soldier. At the reactor, they find monsters created by overexposure to Maku, and Sephiroth starts to doubt the circumstances of his birth, believing that he too might be a monster. Suddenly, Genesis appears and tells Sephiroth he is a product of the Genova Project S. Professor Hojo's and Professor Gast's side of the Genova Project. Sephiroth cannot create copies of himself, and thus doesn't degrade. Genesis asks Sephiroth for his genetic material to help him cure his degradation, seeing as Sephiroth is the perfect monster, created from the Genova Project. But Sephiroth refuses the wishes of his old friend. With his past in doubt and Genesis's word in question, Sephiroth descends into the local Shinra Manor basement and reads Professor Gast's file on Project S of the Genova Project. Sephiroth comes to believe Genova is an ancient and the last of their race and the rightful heir to the planet, blaming the extinction of the ancients on the humans who abandoned them during their time of need. Driven to insanity by the flawed knowledge of his birth, Sephiroth then goes on a rampage and razes Nibelheim to the ground, killing most of the population. Sack pursues him up the mountain to the reactor, where Sephiroth tries to free his mother from her containment tank, concealed within the very heart of the reactor, cutting Tifa down along the way. Sack confronts Sephiroth, but is defeated by the legendary soldier, before Cloud arrives and catches Sephiroth off guard. Furious over his mother's death and his childhood friend Tifa's grave injuries, Cloud throws Sephiroth into the livestream along with Genova's head, before falling unconscious. Professor Hojo, the mastermind behind Project S, takes Sax and Cloud's beaten bodies and starts a new experiment to create Sephiroth clones to test his reunion theory. In the process, Sack and Cloud are infused with Sephiroth's cells, but are deemed failures and left lying asleep in tanks for 4 years, until Sack is awoken by what seems to be Angeal. Since Sack is a soldier, and resistant to Mako due to the soldier process, he has the strength to drag himself and a catatonic Cloud out of a rebuilt Nibelheim through the ranks of Shinra soldiers. To ease Cloud's recovery from Mako poisoning, Sack lends Cloud a soldier first class uniform, discarding his old Mako-soaked clothes. Sack and Cloud escape via the countryside and run into Cisne, who reveals Shinra has dispatched her to capture the two. She is shocked the escapees she was sent to hunt down are Sack and Cloud, and seeing Cloud in a bad state, agrees to let the two go, even going as far as to lend Sack a motorcycle with a sidecar for Cloud. While on the run, Sack and a near-vegetative Cloud run into Genesis and his copies. Since Sack and Cloud are infused with S-cells, Genesis wishes to capture the two to help stop his degradation. A Genesis copy tests Genesis's plan by eating a lock of Sack's hair, but this intended remedy turns the copy into a monster. Sack travels to his hometown of Gongaga to see his parents, but Cisne arrives on the scene to warn him, telling Sack that going to Gongaga is too obvious, and that Shinra will expect it. She also tells him that Angeal has been sighted in the area, but Sack isn't all that surprised, since he already had a vision of him in the tank at Nibelheim. Genesis and Hollander, now a Genesis copy himself, attack the two of them in the hope of securing Cloud and the last pure S-cells in the world, Sack's having been tainted due to the Mako treatment he underwent as a member of Soldier. Angeal swoops in to protect Sack and Cloud from Hollander before Sack kills the mad scientist. As Sack confronts his former mentor, the person who Sack thought was Angeal turns out to actually be Director Lazard, now an Angeal copy, dying of the same degradation Genesis and his copy suffer from. Having let go of his vendetta against Shinra, Lazard has inherited Angeal's feelings of honor and wishes to save the world, which is why he is helping Sack. Sack finally pieces together where Genesis has been hiding for so long, figuring that Genesis is always carrying a Benora white apple, and thus must have been hiding in Benora. Sack leaves Cloud with Lazard, while he makes his way into an underground cavern beneath the land that used to be Benora Village. The land is overflowing with the Lifestream, whose power makes the apple ripen on the surface. Sack finds Genesis's old hideout, which he used as a child, and learns that Genesis's childhood dream was to share a Benora white apple with the soldier hero Sephiroth. Inside the cavern, Loveless is engraved upon stone tablets that tell a short story of a group of three friends who go in the search for the gift of the goddess, taking on the roles of a hero, a traveler, and a prisoner. The prisoner escapes and is critically wounded, only to end up in the care of a woman from the enemy faction whom he falls in love with. He lives a peaceful life, but is tortured by the promise he made to his friends. Sack finds Genesis hiding at the end of the cave with a statue of the goddess, holding the goddess Materia, a gigantic natural materia, or crystallized lifestream. He claims the epic poem Loveless, to now be fulfilled as the three friends the epic speaks of are reunited, with Zack inheriting Angeal's will and Sephiroth's cells. Genesis absorbs the Materia's power, transforms into Genesis' avatar, and engages Zack in battle. Zack defeats Genesis' avatar, and Genesis returns to human form once more. Now healed of his degradation by the goddess Materia, Genesis fights Zack, but is nevertheless defeated. Subsequently, Genesis finds himself in a place filled with a life stream, and sees the statue turn into the goddess herself. As he approaches her, however, the goddess closes her eyes, refusing to embrace him at this time. Zack drags Genesis' limp body up to the surface to join a comatose Cloud and a dying Lazard in a bizarre picnic of half-dead bodies. Lazard had just fought Shinra's soldiers, with the help of a canine Angeal copy, which Zack recognizes as the same one that defended Aerith at the church years ago. Both are dying from their wounds and degradation. Zack gathers everyone with Benora Whites and symbolically completes the reenactment of Loveless, with Genesis as the prisoner, Angeal represented by his copies as the wanderer, and Zack himself as the hero. Zack bites into the apple, fulfilling Genesis' childhood dream in spirit. As Lazard and the Angeal copy die and fade away, a letter is left behind, the 89th Aerith sent during the intervening 4 years, and the last he sent before giving up on receiving reply. Zack is shocked to discover he has been gone 4 years, and desperate to return to her, makes his way toward Midgar. After Zack and Cloud depart, Nero and Weiss, the future leaders of Deep Ground, a top-secret military organization run by Shinra, arrive dressed as first-class soldiers and carry the unconscious Genesis away, leaving his copy of Loveless behind. Genesis' disembodied voice recites the final act of Loveless, his words mysteriously appearing on the page. Zack mobilizes the Turks to find Zack before the Shinra army does, in order to save him, Zack safeguarding all the letters Aerith had sent Zack. However, before Zack can reach Midgar, the Shinra army tracks him down, and although Zack fights valiantly, he is ultimately overwhelmed and mortally wounded. Left lying on a precipice looking over Midgar, Zack feels his life fading away, as does Aerith, tending to her garden a few short miles away. As Cloud finally begins to recover from the Mako poisoning, he sees his friend dying and crawls over to him, Zack telling him that he will be his living legacy, like Angeal before him. Zack then passes on the Buster's sword and his soldier honor to Cloud. In Zack's final moments, Angeal descends from the sky as an angel to bring him into the life stream. Carrying the Buster's sword, Cloud wanders into Midgar as Zack's lingering voice tells Cloud to say hello to Aerith for him, and asks if he has finally become a hero. Cloud's Mako poisoning has left him weak, and seeing Zack die shatters his mind. As he reaches Midgar, he declares himself a soldier first class, and is seen riding a train towards Mako Reactor 1. Buster's sword in hand, the story continuing in Final Fantasy VII. Thanks for watching. I hope you liked the video, and that it helped you appreciate Crisis Core's story even more. Maybe it even helped you appreciate Final Fantasy VII more. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel and click that bell to stay updated on more videos. We thank you for your support. But until next time, kakao!